Hallelujah. It's good to be in the house of the Lord one more time.
Amen. Our purpose is to share the love of Christ, to be dedicated in service to others, to be disciplined in giving, responsible in stewardship, true in worship, faithful in prayer, and passionate in the study of God's word. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's worship him. Let's give him a hand clap of praise. God is good, and he's good all the time. Hasn't he blessed you? Hasn't he kept you? Amen. Somebody ought to say amen this morning. Let's hear from our preacher this morning. Amen.
Amen. How many came to see Jesus this morning? Amen. 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 We came here to worship God and to see Jesus. I'm excited about seeing Jesus. Sometimes we pray and we ask the Lord, I'm praying, Lord, to see Jesus. But I'm telling you what I'm praying. I'm praying to see Jesus this morning. Amen. So stay in the place of worship as we look to see Jesus. I thank God for this opportunity to come before you once again this morning. And God allows us this time to worship. And God allows us the time to come together. I thank and honor God this morning. Give all honor to Pastor Finley, and we continue to pray for him as well for the task that he has in this house. Praying for Pastor Woodbury, God will continue to bless him. To my dear Sister Sheila, and Sister Sharon, we're praying for you. God will continue to bless you in your loss. God will continue to be with you. Turn with me to Numbers, the 13th chapter. Numbers, the 13th chapter. Kind of move around this morning, reading and skipping around chapter 13. I'm going to read chapter 1 through 3, skip down to verse 17, and then read verse 27 through 30. When you have it, say amen. If you don't have it, say hold up. All right, I think we're all on point this morning. Numbers chapter 13, verse 1. It reads, and the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, send men to spy out the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the children of Israel from each tribe of their fathers. You shall send a man, everyone, a leader among them. So Moses sent them from the wilderness of Paran, according to the commandments of the Lord, all of them men who were heads of the children of Israel. Now moving down to verse 17, then Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan and said to them, go up this way into the south and go up to the mountains. Moving down to verse 27, reads, then they told him and said, we went to the land where you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land are strong, and the cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there, and the Amalekites dwell in the land of the south. The Hittites, the Jebusites, and the Amorites dwell in the mountains. And the Canaanites dwell at the sea and on the banks of the Jordan. I'll end right there. Title of this is Passion for the Promise. Passion for the Promise. You may be seated. There was a young lady named Sandy. Sandy had been approached by her boss, and she had been given the greatest opportunity to entertain the CEO of her company. And she would entertain him in her home. And so her boss told her that the CEO of the company is a wine expert, and he enjoys some of the best of wine. And if she would just have this wine available for her CEO, she was due a promotion. So as they're having their dinner, Sandy goes downstairs to the cellar. She brings up the wine, and she's looking at the wine. She's taking the bottle, and she's talking about the color that's in the wine and how beautiful it is. And this is some of the best wine there is. And oh, it just, when you taste it, you'll see how great this wine is. And she's talking for an hour about this wine. Well, her boss tells her, you're not getting the promotion that you expected because you spent too much time talking about the wine and looking at the wine. Sandy is like many of our Christians today. We spend too much time talking about the promises of God. We spend too much time looking at Jesus. We spend too much time telling people about Jesus, but not really busting the seal on the bottle and sharing with others about Jesus. We just spend too much time with the looks and not really living it. The Bible says we have been sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit. Most Christians will not get promoted because of spending too much time with talking about and not breaking the seal of the promises of the Holy Spirit in sharing this for promotion. This story is about Moses. When Moses has been given the instructions to give the instructions to 12 leaders to go and spy and find the promised land. And let's look at the promised land, and there are some details that he wants them to get. He sends them to the highest point that they could see all of God's promises. Like God does, he sends us to a certain place to see his promises. He wants them to see it from a different perspective at the highest point, to see the promises of God. And so to find out these details, because they are going to be able to capture this land, they need to see how strong, how weak, how good, how bad, how fat, how lean, but to get some details to make an attack. And so when they get there, they need to now send a report as to what their findings were. 10 of the 12 men came back with a different report. Now, part of the report of all of them said that it is filled with milk and honey. In other words, in today's term, they came back and said, man, that place is off the chain. Man, there is some stuff over there. They got all kind of fruit. They got all kind of stuff over there. Man, it's a blessing over there. And it's a blessing to see what they have over there. But two of them, Caleb and Joshua, they had a report that, yes, the same. is filled with milk and honey. 10 of those said, well, it's milk and honey, but it's some giants over there. It's some big giants over there, and I don't know about the giants. I don't know about what we're going to be able to do to handle these giants. And so I wonder here, because this is my problem I have that I'm trying to solve with this sermon. How is it that you can sit next to somebody in church, you get it, but they don't? They living the same life you living. They going through the same difficulties you are. They getting the same blessings you are. They heard God just like you did. And then they'll leave church and say, I didn't get that. I just didn't get it. And then the other person leaves and they just shouting, they just glorifying God. They just excited about what God is doing in their life, and they just excited about everything. They seen it, but you didn't. So what happened? What happens? Caleb and Joshua has passion. They have a passion to see the promise. They have a passion to see Jesus. They came wanting to see Jesus. I told you my prayer is that we all see Jesus today. They came wanting to see Jesus. And so what happens to us, and this happened to me even while preparing this about a week ago, I wake up in the middle of the night and I say, oh, everything God done told me, I done wrote the sermon out. I said, oh, this ain't gonna go good. This ain't gonna go good. You need to start working on another sermon. This ain't gonna go good. Because anxiety begins to set in. That's what we do, because anxiety says, I don't really know what the outcome is going to be. I'm not really sure about the outcome. I see the beginning, but I'm not really sure about the outcome. And so this is what happened to the other 10, because they don't see the outcome of the promises of God. They don't see what God is going to do in their life. They don't see the blessings that are going to come about in their life. So they can't see the outcome. So they're kind of afraid. Like some of y'all, listen to me right now. You don't know the outcome. You're kind of aware. You're kind of wondering about what I'm talking about. You say, well, now I ain't going to praise God because I'm kind of unsure about where he's going. I'm not really knowing what's going to happen. So I kind of have a little bit of anxiety. But I'm telling you, we want to see Jesus this morning, right? So the only way you're going to see Jesus, you got to put yourself in the right position and the right purpose of God. If you put yourself in the right position and purpose of God, and your uncertainties will go away. See, no matter what happens with me, I may mess up today. Right? It doesn't matter, because God is the one that's blessing you. God is the one that's blessing you. So you got to just take what you're going to get from God. So if we put ourselves in the right purpose and position to possess the promises of God, then we have to have the right passion to see the promises. What is passion? Passion is almost out of control with excitement, enthusiasm, and to be totally submerged, to be totally submerged. So passion to see the promises. We've got to have a passion to see the promises. Have a passion to see Jesus. Come in with the right mindset. I want to see Jesus. I want to see Jesus. I got to have a passion. I want to see Jesus. I want to see Jesus. Everything in our life is about our passion that we have. The person that you fell in love with was about passion. It's because you wanted to see something. You wanted to see, you seen the outcome. You seen what was going to happen with that marriage or that relationship. So you gained a passion for that. We come to church because we have a passion for this church. And so we have an excitement and enthusiasm about it because we can see the outcome. I'm glad Pastor Whitberry is here this morning. I know that Pastor Woodbury has had a passion for this church. Why? Because he could see the outcome in the beginning. I know where God is going to lead us. I know that there is something going to happen through this. See, they didn't go over into the promised land. Moses was saying, hey, there's something over there. God had already told him, there is something over there. And so go ahead, go on over there and look for it, because God has sent them to that place. God has sent you to a lot of places in life because God has a love and a passion for you. And so he's just telling you, go ahead and have passion. Don't have anxiety and worry about what's happening, what the outcome is going to be. You've got to put yourself in the right purpose. To understand your purpose, you must first understand God's purpose for your life. Here is God's purpose for your life. Sit up straight in your seat. You got to listen to this. Sit up straight. This is him. This is him. God's purpose for your life. Here it is. Here it is. Here it is. To bless you. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's his purpose for your life, is to bless you. That's always been God's purpose throughout all of history, was to bless Israel, to bless all of them. And he sends his blessing all the way down through Jesus Christ. So that's why I want to see Jesus, because God wants to bless you. God wants to bless you in everything. Even when trouble comes along, God is trying to bless you. And so God has an intention to bless you. So not only do you have the right purpose, but you must have the right position. What is right position? Conditions change, but a position in God never changes. My position in Christ is I'm saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. And as long as I'm black, that ain't gonna change. That's my position. That's my position. So we get these positions like we get on a job. We get a position. We're so satisfied that we got that position. And then we don't do nothing else with that position. I got my position. I'm working over here at such and such company. I'm just satisfied with this position. And then I don't even try to add no skill levels. See, because once you get the position, you got to start adding to that position. Don't just stay in that position. Some of us have gotten saved and we just are satisfied with that position and not adding to that position. Not adding some skill levels to that position. In 2 Peter 1 and 5, it says, for this very reason, make every effort, passion, make every effort to add to your faith, add to your faith. You saved? Okay. But you need to add to your faith. Add some skill levels. Add this skill. Goodness. Knowledge. Self-control, perseverance, godliness, mutual affection, and love. Add them skill levels to where you're at now. Sure, you've got your position. It's not going to change, but you need to add some skill levels. Because if you have the right position and the right purpose, you can get the promise. God wants to promote you. But if you don't have the right purpose and position, you won't be able to see the promises. You're not going to get the effects of the promises because you haven't put yourself in the right position or purpose. He says, he goes on to say this in the 8th verse. For if you possess, that's what we're trying to get, these qualities in increasing measures, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive. Same thing happens on the job. How do you become more effective and more productive? Add some skill levels. How do you get your promotion? Add your skill levels. See, God has a promotion for all of us if we just add some skill levels to where we're at now. Don't just be satisfied with your position. You must add to your position. Point number two, passion for people. When they went over, the people looked really big. They were like, oh man, these people are too big. We can't handle this. We can't handle it. They too big. They they large? And so, you know, are we looking at the people or are we looking at God? And then you say to yourself, you know what? I don't even like people. Now I'm going to tell you the truth. I used to not like y'all. I mean, really, if we really look at the truth, we just used to not like people. And that's normal. That's normal. For somebody that's not a Christian, don't like people. They didn't have a passion for people. And so we have to establish a passion for people. If we're going to do this work, we have to have a passion for people, a love and excitement for people. And that's really difficult because the biggest thing in most people's life is people. I know we say in relationship is finances and stuff like that, but really your problem is people. We really have a problem with people. So this is what helps in getting to really the center of things. Here's what he told them. Go inspect the fruit. If you just look at the fruit God has placed in you and how large you are, you will begin to see what you really are made of. What you really are made of. You know, for a rich man, when he walks in a place and he has all the money, boy, his head stands up tall. I got money. He wants you to look at him because he got money. And so he can hold his head because he is dependent upon his money. Christians a lot of times don't really hold their heads up because they don't realize what they got. They don't realize how big they are. And how large they are. It's what God has put in you. God has put some big stuff in you. And you ought to be able to hold your head up when you walk in the community. Because God has blessed you with some awful big fruit. Look at this. In 1 John 4:4. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. God has made you very large. As you look at how large love is, has become in your life. Remember I said, I used to not like y'all. God has put some new fruit in me. And so now he allows you to look. Inspect the fruit. Inspect the fruit. He's been able to put some peace in you. In some storms that you normally were not able to go through, God has given you peace. Inspect the fruit. You got some joy beyond all understanding. You shouldn't be as happy as you are right now, but God has done some great things in you. And so when you walk in the community, walk with your head up. Walk with your head up because of what God can do even in your life. You should know that he can do anything. He can do anything if he can turn you around. I know if he can turn me around. I know God can do some mighty things. God is just that good. So then we need to have this passion for people. We got to realize that people is where we get paid. People is how we get our promotion. If you look at Numbers and go to the next chapter, in chapter 14, in verse 9, it says this. Because these 10 began to rebel against God because of all of the complaining that they were doing and because they didn't think that it could happen. They say this, only do not rebel against the Lord, nor fear the people of the land. Get this, for they are your bread. For they are your payday. For they are your promotion. People, people, people. You know them big people? You know them people that you sick of? The people that you don't want to deal with on your job? That's your payday. That's your bread. People, people, people. I know some of you don't even want to hear that. Because you don't even want to deal with them. Because you ain't got to that level yet of loving them people. don't even have a passion for them people. But I began to realize that this is how we get paid. This is how God is going to bless us. You know, sometimes you just got to go forgive people that are your worst enemy. God has a promotion for you. God has a blessing for you. Then he goes on to say, the protection has departed from them. See, you know, sometimes we go to people, you know, God tells us to go witness to some people, and we're so afraid of them. We're so afraid because we think that they're so big. We think that some of the issues in our life are so big. God, I can't handle that. That's too big. God says, I done took the protection away from them. All that Satan could do to you, I got you. I got you. Don't worry about it. Because he says, and then he says, and the Lord is with us. The Lord is with us. Hear that. The Lord is with us. The Lord is with us. We can get it. We can handle anything because the Lord is with us. You got to know that. I want you to stand with your head high, lift it up. Stand up like the rich man and know that the Lord is with you. There is something big in you. You got to stand with confidence and know that God is with me. See, you're fighting some battles all by yourself. You need to quit handling these battles by yourself. Just know that God is with me. You can speak against these enemies. You can speak against Satan. Because when you know that God is with you, when you know that God is on your side, he says, do not fear them. Do not fear them. I'm telling you from experience, because I know that God has done some great things in me. I used to be scared of my own shadow. I looked at a picture about 2 days ago. It was a picture when I was probably about, 7 years old. And I already got some big eyes. But then my eyes were just poked out of my head. And I was looking at something in that picture. I was looking just as scared. I'm like, what was you looking at? My shadow. Wasn't looking at nothing but my shadow. You know, scared of people. Scared to approach people. Scared to talk up here. Scared to deal with life. Scared to deal with everything that God has and puts before me. Scared to deal with it. But God can turn you around. But see, you got to be able to step up to it. Step up to the plate and be able to deal with it. Because in order for you to get the promotion, in order for you to really get God's blessing, there are some things you got to go through. I know there are some wildernesses that you got to walk through. I know there's just some issues that you're going to have to go through. But God has something for you. God has a blessing in store for you if you just go ahead and walk through it. I know that you're thinking it doesn't look so good. I know that sometimes we come to church and we hear all of the fruit that Pastor Finley gives, and we say, oh, man, that's some good fruit. And then we get out there on the streets, but them people. That's what they were doing. That's what they were doing. They were saying, with anxiety, but the people. But they too large. Not only are the people, but my issue is too large. And so we have a different mindset when we really get out there to deal with. But God has a blessing for you. Point number 3, passion to pause. Passion to pause. I didn't read this verse. This is verse 30. It says this. Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome. Caleb quieted the people. What happened to the day that when we would come in church and the urchins? It was some strong urchins. I remember back in the day. They'd have the doorknob, and you ain't even getting in church when it was altar call time. You better be still. You better be still, because God is talking right now. You better sit still because God needs to speak to somebody right now. And so they stop everything. Every movement, you don't stand up. And if you do stand up, you better put that finger up. Because you know you done messed up by getting up, period. So God's talking right now. So we got to be quiet and listen to God. Sometimes we got to sit down in prayer and just listen to God. And we got to have a passion for that. A passion for prayer. A passion to really listen for God. A passion that I want to see Jesus. See, when you get to a place that's saying, look, I got to see Jesus in this situation. I got to see Jesus as I go through this wilderness, as I go through this issue. I want to see Jesus. So you sit still and you just listen to God. What is God saying to me? Where is God leading me? How is God leading me in my life right now? You just got to be quiet. And so here is Caleb. Because Caleb is trying so hard to get them to see Jesus because he wants them to be still, to just listen to what God is saying. What is God saying today? What is God saying to your life? I don't have any notes on my paper right now. I'm just speaking from the heart of God. What is God saying to your life? That you want to take time to really just pause and just listen to God. That you won't just get everything, all of the noise out. The 10 men, they was making a whole bunch of noise. Because they saying, God can't do it. God can't do it. He can't get us through this. He can't get us through this promise. We can't do it. We can't do it. I can't make it. I can't do it. Moses has sent us over here, but he sent us all the way from Egypt. He can do it. He can do it. Because Caleb and Joshua had a passion. They had a passion driving in them. See, God has done something in me. He's turned me around to have a passion for people, to have a passion to see the promise, to have a passion to see Jesus. And so God did something to this little boy that was scared of his own shadow. And God has done some great things, and I'm so thankful for God. I'm so thankful for what God has done in my life. Because I wouldn't be here where I'm at if it wasn't for the Lord in my life. And I trust him with everything there is because of how good he's been to me. God will keep you. God will take care of you. But I'm telling you, you got to start having a passion and a love for him. Give him your life. Give him everything you got because he gave his passion for you. And so once you just let go, and like Sandy, there was something in the bottle. There was something great in the bottle. But sometimes you just got to break the seal. You got to allow God to use you. You got to let somebody know what's really in the bottle. What's really in this bottle? Don't sit there and talk about it. Bust the seal and let people know the goodness of God. Let somebody know how wonderful he is and how good he's been to you. Because there is a Jesus that needs to be seen out of the bottle. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Because it is the power of God that strengthens me. It's the power of God that keeps me. It's the power of God that's walking with me right now. See, the only reason I can stand tall is because of the power of God. And so let us rely on that power. Let us rely on that strength. And it is that strength that'll take you through the wilderness in life. It is the strength of God that will do what he promised that he will do. And so once we have a passion for this promise, that he sent his son one day, and one dark Friday he died on the cross. Yeah, get a passion for it. Because he died on the cross with passion in his heart. He died on that Friday. And for 3 days and 3 nights, he remained in that grave. All for you while you were in your sins, while you didn't care about people, while you didn't care about life. He died on that cross for you and for me. With love in his heart, he wants to take care of you because God wants to bless you. God wants you in the right position to bless you. And so God has given his all to you. But God knew what the outcome was. Jesus knew what the outcome was. He didn't get any anxiety. Yes. God raised him from the dead. Yeah, that was the outcome. That's always been the outcome for you. That's always the outcome for you, that God is going to raise you from the dead. Yeah. So I stand with my head up high, knowing that I stand on the power of God and what God can do for you. God wants to bless you. I pray you've seen Jesus today. God wants to bless you. God wants to keep you because God loves you and he wants to keep you and bless you. Amen. God be with you until we meet again.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Somebody in the church say amen. Come on, say amen again. Thank you so much, Pastor Bell, for that powerful message. I just want to extend the invitation. There may be someone who's heard this message and has been lit on fire with a desire to see Jesus Christ and to know him as Lord of your life. I want to extend this invitation. There may be one listening or watching who wants to give their life to Christ here in the sanctuary. Listen, let me let you know that God still loves you. He so loved you that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believeth in him would not perish but have eternal life. That's how much God loves you, that he was willing to give up his only son for you. That passion of Christ. And I want to also let you know that you don't have to be perfect to come to God, because none of us will ever reach perfection. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, according to Romans 3:23. But even in that, God did demonstrate his love that he gave his life for you. You have a choice today. You can either choose to live the way you want to live, or you can give your life to Christ. And what you will get is a gift called salvation. Something you don't have to pay, something you don't have to earn. He gives it to you out of his love, his grace, and his mercy for you. All you have to do is just confess Jesus Christ, believe that God has raised him from the dead, and thou shalt be saved. If there is one today and you want to be saved, you want to give your heart to Jesus Christ, this is the hour you can come. There may be someone also who just wants to recommit their life to Christ. Maybe they haven't been walking as closely with him as they had in the past. There's been some obstacles that have come, and there's been some giants in their way. But now they see and have been renewed in their sight that they have Jesus Christ in their life, that God is dwelling in them, and they want to recommit their life back to Christ. They want to actually use the power and the gift that is in them to overcome whatever comes in their life. Maybe you want to recommit your life to Christ. You can come. There may be somebody here who doesn't have a church home who wants to come and be a part of the First Baptist family. Listen, we would want you to be here because this is a place where we definitely preach and teach Jesus Christ as Lord, crucified and resurrected on the third day. Amen. This is the hour you can come. If there is one, why don't you do it? If you're on chat, if you're viewing this, you can just write whatever your desire is, and we'll make sure we reach out to you about your decision today. But I just want to give this invitation. Is there one today? Is there one today that wants to give their life to Christ, who wants to rededicate their life to Christ, who wants to join in fellowship with the First Baptist Church? Amen. If there was one, why don't you come? Why don't you come today? Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. There is one coming. God bless you. God bless you. Again, if you're joining us on Facebook, on Zoom, all you have to do is write in the chat and we'll reach out to you. I do want to say thank you again for joining with us. In just a few moments on the screen, you'll see how you can continue to support our ministry or how you can reach out to us. But we want to again thank you for joining with us today. It is my prayer that God's peace and blessings will go with you always. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. Thank you. Is there another?